of you have seen a movie trailer that provided too much information? I mean, you know the characters, you know the plot, you know how it escalates because you've seen the explosions, you've seen all the car chases and the fight scenes, and by the time you're done watching the trailer, you think to yourself, why should I bother watching the movie? Why should I kill 2 hours when I can guess how it comes together? See, so many times we fight against movie trailers and spoiler alerts. I mean, don't get me started on spoiler alerts. I mean, we chastise people if they spoil the movie for us. And we try to avoid any type of spoiler alert when it comes to any movie or even books that we read. But you know what's interesting? There's been a lot of research done in the last 10 years that have demonstrated people actually prefer spoiler alerts. I kid you not. And researchers have asked, why is that the case? I mean, why would people want to know in advance how the movie or how the book concludes? And one of their best suggestions is, when you know how the story ends, it allows you to focus in on the details and to actually derive a greater understanding of the movie or the story itself. In the biblical book of 1 Corinthians, we have the greatest spoiler alert imaginable. And it tells us how we're going to spend eternity and what it will be like to have a resurrected body one day. Now you may think, well, Keith, now you've told me how this passage is going to conclude. Why should I bother listening? Well, the great thing is, now you'll be able to plumb the depths of this passage, not just today, but in the days, weeks, and months to come, where you can discover what your mortality and your eternality will be like. In 1 Corinthians 15, we're going to look at a passage out of what's called the resurrection chapter. Now, this particular chapter emphasizes the future bodily resurrection of believers in Jesus Christ more than any other chapter in the Bible, and even more than any other book in the entire Bible. What the Apostle Paul is going to argue is simply this: when we die, we have truly begun to live. Paul's argument is that we were called and created to be able to enjoy the afterlife with God and with those who love God. And so what he does is he provides for us two resurrection realities in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 35 through 49. And he's going to bring about, for our purposes, the greatest movie trailer of all time concerning coming attractions. The first resurrection reality is found in verses 35 through 41. And that is, our heavenly bodies are familiar yet unique. The Apostle Paul is going to say that we will be recognizable in the eternal state. But yet there will be parts of our new body that will be very different than what we are accustomed to in our present earth suit. Now, what Paul has done in the first half of 1 Corinthians 15 is he's established the fact of the resurrection, that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and if we place our faith in Jesus, we too can rise from the dead. But now Paul is going to explain not the fact of the resurrection, but the how-to of the resurrection. And that's the second half of 1 Corinthians 15. Now, because Paul has established the fact, he's a wise enough teacher to know that whenever you make some cardinal statements, people are going to object. There's going to be cynics, skeptics, and critics. So Paul brings that out in verse 35. Listen to these words. Paul writes, "But someone will say, How are the dead raised? And with what kind of body do they come? Paul acknowledges there is some real cynicism, doubt, and unbelief in Corinth. In chapter 15, verse 12, just several verses earlier, Paul says there are some in Corinth who are believers in Jesus, who have trusted in his resurrection, but they don't believe that they will rise from the dead, at least not physically and bodily. Now you may be saying, how is that possible? Isn't that one of the basic truths of Christianity? It is. But some in Corinth held to a dualistic Greco-Roman view that distinguished between the body and the soul. So to make it simple, the soul was seen as good, and it would go on and last forever. The body was bad, and it would eventually perish. And so the Corinthians, at least some of them, have some skeptics, some people that are getting up in Paul's face and saying some hard things. See, we may think that these questions are innocent, and that these individuals, they really want to learn and grow from the Apostle Paul's teaching. That's not the case. They're actually creating problems for him. This is what we could call New Testament era snark. They're trying to go after Paul. So they're saying things like, how can you believe that physical bodies that are experiencing decay can one day rise from the dead? How can you be so gullible, Paul? Everyone knows that once you die, you die. Your spirit may ascend, but your body, it's going to stay in the grave. In our contemporary vernacular, Paul's critics would have probably said, what are you talking about, Paul? Reanimated corpses? Walking bones? You talking about a zombie apocalypse, Paul? They're saying, this doesn't make sense. These outliers are arguing that Paul is out to lunch. But let's just step back for a moment. God created Adam, the first human, from dust. Can he not reconstruct humanity from dust and ashes? I think if we have the creator and the sustainer of the universe and of human life, certainly he's capable of resurrecting dead people. It's all molecules after all. Just stop and think of what Scripture says and what you may have even heard before. Nothing is impossible for God. If nothing is impossible for God, that's certainly true of the bodily resurrection of people who have trusted in Jesus. But let's face it, this argument doesn't satisfy everyone. It's often called circular reasoning. We establish God as creator, and then it follows that he will one day raise us up from the dead. So Paul, being a master teacher, decides, let me respond to this snark. You fool! Verse 36. He says, you're a foolish fellow. You're a foolish gal. To think that the God of the universe is not capable of resurrecting the dead. But Paul doesn't just call a person fool in the sense that we would. In the Bible, a fool is someone who chooses not to see how God is relevant. A fool is someone in this context who says, God is not the all-powerful creator. And so the fool denies God's involvement in raising people from the dead. Paul is now going to argue how God goes about doing this. He doesn't just say, you fool, God is the creator. He actually illustrates for us how resurrection can take place. So the first question of verse 35 is answered in verses 36 through 41. Paul begins by arguing in verses 36 through 38 that there's a distinction between the seed and the plant, between the sowing and the harvest. Look at these verses with me. That which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And that which you sow, you do not sow the body which is to be, but a bare grain, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body, just as he wished, and to each of the seeds a body of its own. Paul says, imagine a grain of wheat. It has the appearance of dying and being buried in the ground, and then it comes out as a full harvest of wheat. Just that little kernel becomes a harvest. Now, that's true of all grains and fruits. Paul is saying that the harvest is greater than the sowing. I want you to imagine that it's a very hot day and you've been working out in your yard. Now, on the east side, that's very hard to imagine. A hot day. But nonetheless, try to imagine it. You come in and you want to be refreshed. You have two choices: a watermelon seed or a slice of watermelon. A cool, crisp slice of watermelon. Which do you choose? The slice, of course. Now, that seed that went into the ground did not remain a seed. It brought about a watermelon. Paul is saying when our bodies, our earthly bodies, are buried in the ground because they've passed, they will one day come out unique and extraordinary when our bodies are reunited with our spirits. Aren't you glad that we will not take these earthly bodies into eternity? I mean, I look at this body and I'm like, Lord, help a brother out. Don't take this body into eternity. So God allows this earthly body to die, be buried, and to come out extraordinary. But yet, the body that's buried is also familiar. It's recognizable. It's similar to the bodies that we have today. Going back to the watermelon, when a watermelon seed is planted in the ground, it does not come out as a kumquat. It comes out as a watermelon. When your body is raised from the dead, you will come out, not someone else. Paul is saying, our bodies are familiar, yet unique when they are raised on the final day. Now, Paul doesn't stop here. He says, okay, I've illustrated this through a harvest, through seeds and plants, but now let me focus in on various types of flesh. Look at these verses. Verse 39, Paul writes, all flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one flesh of men and another flesh of beasts, and another flesh of birds, and another of fish. Now, verses 39, 40, and 41 are actually the last 3 days of Genesis 1 in reverse order. Now, you don't need to remember that. What you need to remember that's actually helpful is human beings were designed to walk, birds were designed to fly, fish were designed to swim. All flesh was created and designed for the particular environment that they live in. That's all that Paul is saying. And I think the reason he illustrates from Genesis 1 is Genesis 1 dealt with God creating out of nothing. But what's greater than Genesis 1 and 2 is the new creation, when God allows us to experience future, literal, bodily resurrection, to live forever with him on a new heaven and new earth. That's why God is so about the resurrection. It's a new creation. So Paul is arguing, when we die, we've truly begun to live. He continues, and now he moves from various fleshly bodies to celestial bodies. Look at verses 40 and 41. Paul says, there are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is one and the glory of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon and another glory of the stars, for star differs from star in glory. Paul is saying, look at the celestial bodies. They radiate throughout the universe. And all of them have different degrees of glory. Even we know the difference between a 25-watt light bulb and a 1,000-watt light bulb. Paul is saying, all of the lights of the universe, nothing, small time, compared to our glorified bodies that will illuminate to the fullest degree possible. It's going to be astounding to observe our resurrected, glorified, heavenly bodies. Paul has argued that our heavenly bodies will be familiar yet unique. That's resurrection reality number one. Now he moves into a second resurrection reality. Our heavenly bodies will be new and improved, like a before and after shot. What we have will be familiar and unique, but it's going to be new and improved. And for those of us who are middle-aged, nothing sounds better than that. What Paul does in verses 42 through 49 is he answers the second question of verse 35. How will our resurrection bodies look? How will they respond? Take a look at verses 42 through 44. Paul puts it like this: so also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown a perishable body, it is raised an imperishable body. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Paul pictures for us, if you will, the fact that we are like caterpillars and we will one day be transformed into butterflies. Now, with all respect to caterpillars, there's no comparison between a caterpillar and a butterfly. But in order to become a proverbial butterfly, spiritually speaking, transformation has to occur. There has to be some type of change from this body to our heavenly bodies. Paul is going to talk about those four changes in verses 42 through 44. First, from perishable to imperishable. We all understand perishable food, don't we? Fruit that eventually goes bad. Bread that has a shelf life. Meat that will rot in our fridge no matter what we do. Trust me, I've tried. I've tried to preserve all of this, but it goes bad. What about non-perishable food? Canned food, dried food, and of course, Twinkies. I mean, Twinkies have a shelf life of at least 75 years. Paul is saying that our resurrected bodies are going to be less like fruit and more like Twinkies. Some of you are saying, wait a second, I already have some Twinkie on my love handles. I mean, my body, my earthly suit is already one big Twinkie. Well, the truth is, we're not talking about your physique. We're talking about the fact that your eternal heavenly body will never expire. It will never perish. In fact, it'll be indestructible. Can you imagine a world with no more pharmacies, hospitals, or funeral homes? I mean, just stop and think. No more tennis elbow, cataracts, or cancer. Because the body will never perish. It will be imperishable. Paul says there's a second change that needs to occur, from dishonor to glory. Many of us are at the place in our lives where we look into the mirror and we say, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, you've got to be kidding. I mean, whatever you do, don't look at yourself in a full-length mirror, especially if you're middle-aged. I mean, I used to flex in front of the mirror. Now I run from the mirror." The body is dishonorable, which is why there are funeral directors and funeral homes to cover up the dishonorable nature of death. And yet the Apostle Paul says, our deathly, temporal bodies, if we've trusted in Christ, will one day be eternal. They will be perfect. And they will be able to ultimately experience fellowship with God and others. It will be glorious. In the same way that the luminaries of the universe are radiating light, our bodies will, because they're glorious, our new bodies. The third change that Paul is going to emphasize is from weakness to power. Don't you love the thought of having a powerful body? I do. I mean, I spend a lot of my time trying to just hold on to the body that I have today. And I have to diet, I have to work out, and it's a losing battle. It's a losing battle because this body is weak. And it's only getting weaker. Those of us who are middle-aged understand this. We understand the five B's of middle-aged. Balding. Bifocals. Bridges. Bulges. And bunions. I'm almost at the point where I'm 5 for 5. I mean, things are getting embarrassing, let's face it. But that's okay. Because it causes us to recognize we can't trust in our power or in our strength. We have to trust in the Lord. There's a sense where we become homesick for heaven, where we realize this life is not all there is. After I graduated from seminary, I did a lot of pastoral care in our first church. And I visited a widow who was living at an assisted living facility. And this woman had a great sense of humor. One day, she said to me, "Keith, my arms are so weak, I can't even bring my coffee up to drink. My eyes are so bad, I can no longer see my toothbrush. I'm dealing with blood pressure medication that causes me to faint. I've got arthritis in my neck so bad I can't even turn it from left to right. But thank God, I'm still driving." I said to this woman, "You're remarkable." And then I thought, I better stay off the roads when she's on the road. Now, she was messing with me, obviously, but she recognized what I do, that our bodies have a shelf life and it's shorter than we'd like. We're more like sour cream and cottage cheese that's about to expire than we are the Twinkie in this life. And yet, Paul promises us that we will have a new body that will be powerful and will be able to handle eternity as we worship and serve the Lord Jesus. Paul now shares a fourth and final change. And this one is the ultimate transformation. It's really different than the prior three. Paul is going to say, our bodies are going to move from natural to spiritual. And what he means by this is, our bodies will be animated not by our human flesh, if we've yet to trust in Christ, our sinful nature, or if we have trusted in Christ, our flesh. See, even those of us who have a new life in Christ, a new nature, we still have a problem with sin. Paul says, not so in your heavenly body. You're going to be perfectly and continuously led by the Holy Spirit of God. Stop and think about that for a moment. No more lust, no more pride, no more selfishness, no more division, no more abuse, no more racism. None of that will have any place in eternity. We will be perfect and we will live in union with God because we are in Christ. That is our standing. It's no longer sinner. It's saint for all of eternity. Paul is very clear. When we die, we've begun to truly live. Now, you may be saying, Keith, I appreciate what you're saying. You're caught up in a future life with God. You're talking about resurrection realities, pie in the sky stuff. You're talking about the then and there. Well, I want to talk about the here and now. I want to know what difference this message is going to make in the nasty here and now. That's legit. The authors of Scripture talked so much about resurrection, not just Jesus' resurrection, but our future bodily resurrection, because they believed that the future resurrection should make a difference in the present. If you're like me and you're recognizing that you're slipping mentally, emotionally, physically, and socially, it's easy to get frustrated at times. But yet, what if our response was, it's not always going to be this way? One day, I'm going to have a perfect mind. I'm going to have a perfect heart. I'm going to have a perfect body. And I will live for eternity with God and with those who love Him. I want you to imagine, God forbid, that sometime this year, you go in for a doctor's appointment to have your MRI results evaluated. And you're waiting in the doctor's waiting room for what seems like an eternity. And she comes out to finally speak to you. And she shares with you the news that you never wanted to hear, that you're terminal. God forbid this year you lose a loved one. Or you may even lose your own life. For some of you, this is all too real. And for all of us, it'll become very real in our future. We're all going to pass from this life. What will give us hope? What will give us assurance and certainty of what lies after the grave? The bodily resurrection. There is nothing more important to establish than where you're going to spend eternity and what your body is going to be like. Paul now draws his argument to a conclusion, and he does so in beautiful fashion. He's going to give us some theologically deep verses in verses 45 through 49, but he makes it plain. He does so with two men. The one who's called the first Adam, which is God's first created human being, Adam. And then one who is called the last Adam, which is a title for the Lord Jesus Christ. Look what Paul does in verses 45 and following. He writes, so also it is written. And then he quotes Genesis 2, verse 7. The first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from the earth, earthy, or of dust. But the second man, this is Jesus, is from heaven. As is the earthy, so also are those who are earthy. And as is the heavenly, so also are those who are heavenly. Just as we have borne the image of the earthy, we will also bear the image of the heavenly. This passage, and really the entire chapter that we've looked at, is so critical. Because Paul cites not just Genesis 2, verse 7 here. He has already referred to Genesis 1. And he does so to help us to understand Christianity is not a human philosophy. It's not a man-made religion. It goes all the way back to the first human being. In fact, it goes back even further to the God who has created the universe and who invites us to enter into a relationship with Christ. He says the first Adam will allow you to live on this earth in an earthen suit of flesh. But the second Adam, the last Adam, he gives you not just earthly life, but heavenly life, if you will simply trust in him. Jesus is the one who gives a life-giving spirit, which includes spirit and body. And he gives you the opportunity to live with him forever, based upon trusting in Christ. So on Easter, our desire should be, I no longer want to be partnered with Adam. I want to be in fellowship with Christ, because Christ will take me into the eternal state where I can fulfill my calling and the reason that I was created. When you die, you've truly begun to live. That's your destiny. And God's desire is that you would join him and those who have believed in him and his Son, the Lord Jesus, for all of eternity. An elderly widow was given 3 months to live. She had developed a terminal illness. Fortunately, she had planned out her entire memorial service. So she called her pastor over and she said, Pastor, here are the hymns I want sung at my funeral. Here are the scripture passages I want read. I want to be buried in this dress. And then I want you to ensure that my favorite Bible is put into the casket with me as well. The pastor said, absolutely, I'll abide by all your wishes. And he began to make his way out. And then the widow said, oh, pastor, I forgot something. One more thing, and this is very, very important. Would you please ensure that I am buried with a fork in my right hand? The pastor was like, what are you talking about? She said, well, I've been in the church for decades. I've been to all the socials and the potlucks. And when I'm sitting at the table, someone always comes over and says, keep your fork. The best is yet to come. Velvet chocolate cake. Deep dish apple pie. She said, I loved looking forward to dessert. And when people see me in that open casket, what I want them to remember is that the best is yet to come. There are two types of people here this morning. Those that have determined where they're going to spend eternity and those who haven't. On Easter Sunday, the most important decision that you can make is to cross over from death to life. The Bible teaches that all people have sinned in thought, in motive, in attitude, in word, in deed. And God will not let sin into his new creation, into his new heaven and earth. So to solve the sin problem, he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, in human flesh to fulfill all of his commands, all of his expectations, and then to die on a cross and to rise from the dead. What we celebrate on Easter is what I call the exclamation point of the Christian faith. If Jesus had just died, that would have been insufficient because he would still be in the grave. But because Jesus rose, he demonstrated that he was God and that all who place their faith in him will one day rise and join him. and will have a resurrected body just like his. Today, I urge you, trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior. Easter has been called the New Year's Day of the soul. And I love that because the thought behind it is, you don't have to wait for January 1st. Easter is the day that is most significant because you can become a new creation. And ultimately, every day can be Easter because Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. Today, if you're in the process of being persuaded that Jesus is who he claims to be, do not think for a second that sin from your past, your present, or sin that you will commit in the future can keep you from a relationship with God. Jesus died for all of your sin, past, present, and future. Your sin can be forgiven, forgotten forever based upon what Jesus has done for you. Will you trust in him today? He wants to give you a heavenly body that will one day inhabit a new heaven and a new earth. Trust in him. If you're already a follower of Christ, but you know you need to renew your faith because the same old churchianity and the religious rituals that you've been going through have left you unchanged, and you want to be transformed, renew your faith in Jesus Christ today. Allow the resurrection of Jesus to resurrect you in your experience. What I want you to hear is simply this. The best is yet to come. One day, if we place our faith in Christ, we will rise from the dead. And we will spend eternity with God and with those who love him. For when we die, we've truly begun to live. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that you raised Jesus from the dead, that you put an exclamation point on Resurrection Sunday. Thank you that you've promised us that we can rise as well. For those of us who are contemplating Christianity in this moment, help us to realize that all we must do is acknowledge our sin and trust in a Savior who has delivered us from sin. If you're watching online, or if you're wrestling right now about that decision, don't delay. Trust in Christ. Let him restore you. Let him prepare you for an eternity with him. Believe in Christ today. I'm going to offer a simple prayer that you can silently pray if you would like. There's nothing saving about a prayer. In fact, right now, you've either been persuaded or you haven't. But for some of us, a prayer is like a stake in the ground or drawing a line in the sand that on April 17, 2022, I trusted in Jesus. If that's your heart, acknowledge that. Father, I've sinned. I have not lived up to your expectations, but I know Jesus has. And I'm trusting in his person and in his work, his death and his resurrection, as my only hope of heaven. And I have confidence in what you've done. If you're persuaded by that reality, you're a child of God. And if someone brought you to Crossroads today, would you simply tell them of that decision that you've made? And if you came on your own initiative, I'm going to be at the Welcome Center with a number of our leaders. Would you tell us that you've trusted in Christ? We'd love to help you grow in your newfound faith. For those of us who are followers of Christ, let's renew our faith and become the faithful people God has called us to be. Father, we worship you and your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the hope of life after death. Thank you that this life is not all there is, but true life awaits us after the grave. We can't wait to be reunited with you and have a glorious homecoming. We thank you for making this possible, Jesus. In your name, amen.